Tonight's topic is an extremely powerful one, one that I've spent a lot of time agonizing over myself, and I've wondered about how to relate to it in the contemporary period. I think there are a lot of fascinating parallels, which we may actually get into a little bit. But it's a little bit of a departure from our usual biographical approach, like the lecture on the Holocaust, where we stepped back and we took a macro historical position and looked a little bit, or as they say, from a 30,000 foot view at the development of this phenomenon. Today we're going to focus on the so-called crypto Jews. I'll spend some time speaking about what that terminology means, but basically the crypto Jews referred to those Jews who chose to go underground during the Inquisition years to outwardly portray themselves as Christians in order to, you know, get along in society. We'll talk about the motivation shortly. And slowly, slowly, over many generations, they desperately tried to hold on to their identity, but it slipped through their fingers. And today we have possibly an incredibly large number of these descendants of Jews, many of whom fit the strictest definition of who is a Jew by the, you know, the most extreme Orthodox rabbi, and nevertheless are completely unaware of their Jewish identity. So that's going to be the topic for tonight. We're not going to look at we will dip into a couple of biographies very briefly, but basically we're going to look at the overall phenomenon of the crypto Jews, and we'll take it all the way from the early 14th century to the present day. Well, first of all, thank you to our sponsors for tonight. My good friends, Katie and Vic Crespin from Miami Beach. They were students of mine in some adult education there for several years, a very fond relationship with them. And they very thankfully sponsored both this lecture and next week's final lecture of the season, which is in memory of the Jews of the expulsion, the 6 million, and all those who died for just being Jewish. Very powerful sentiment from the Crespins. Thank you very much. Just to clarify, good and welfare, what's going on next week? We have our final lecture of the spring season. We're going to look at the great Harav Ovadia Yosef, who actually represents Mizrahi Jewry, because I want to spend some time speaking about the influence of Sephardi thought on the Eastern communities. Very important rabbi, extremely significant in Israeli politics, the leader of the Shas party, and so on. If you are out of town this weekend, those of you who are going to Boston, I'm very pleased that I'm invited. I will be back Monday, God willing, but on Friday, if you happen to be in Boston, and for those of you in the internet audience, I'm giving a lecture at Harvard University, which is sometimes called the Touro of Cambridge. And it's going to be on, I give two lectures. One is going to be on Friday morning, and I'm really grateful to them because they invited me to speak on Saturday, and I said, it's not happening, and I'm sorry. And they said, okay, how about Friday? And it worked out really well. It was really, really kind of them. The topic is Ukrainians and Jews since Huri. Huri refers to the Harvard Ukrainian Research Institute, with which I am affiliated, that is probably the premier institution of Ukrainian studies in the world. And they've done a lot of really creative work on this history of the Jews in Ukraine. So I'll be speaking about that. That's the last 50 years of Ukrainian and Jewish relations. Then afterwards, after Shabbos begins, I'm going to head over to Chabad of Harvard. Well, I'll give a lecture on my most recent book, which is on the Piasechna Rebbe, the Rebbe of the Warsaw Ghetto, and I certainly encourage you, and especially those of you who are watching from Boston or Cambridge, come on by. There's going to be a great meal, and I think it's going to be nice. And my wife will be there, too. Okay, let's go straight to, oh, now one last thing. In case you, I really apologize for those of you who came last week and I was not here, as I mentioned. Unfortunately, we had an illness in the family that I had to go up north. I did send out emails. If you follow me on Facebook or Twitter or even Instagram, you would see these things. But if you want to get emails, what you do is go to my website, which is Henry Abramson, or jewishhistorylectures.com. And then down here in the corner is this little button that says follow. And it gives you the option to enter your email address, and you'll get updates on the classes. Also, the links to the videos, if you want to share them, things like that. So please do sign up. It's a way that I can communicate with you over the summer as well, so you can prepare for the fall series. Topic is still TBA. Okay. So let us go to the material itself now. That's it for the good news. The source for today, the primary source that I'm really going to rely on heavily, is this amazing book by David Gitlitz, who is an administrator like me and still has time to do amazing scholarship. I'm so impressed with this book. He and his wife, shown here, have focused on all kinds of aspects of the social history of Spanish Jewry, and particularly the conversos that we'll be speaking about. And this work, Secrecy and Deceit, The Religion of the Crypto-Jews, is really an amazing piece of scholarship. I have to say, I got a tremendous amount of information from it. It's written with great sensitivity to the internal realities of the conversos, and I highly recommend it to anyone who wants to study this topic further. I'm going to, as is my way, be purely derivative in this class. It'll be an extended book review, but really it's a great source, and I highly recommend it. Let's get into the definitions, first of all. What are we talking about? This is, of course, one of the famous pieces of art relating to the conversos or the crypto Jews. It's one of the Velázquez pieces, and it shows a Jew wearing the San Benito with the dunce's cap. This is, of course, a ritual humiliation that people accused of Judaizing would be forced to wear this, and they would face public opprobrium, and that was part of their penance. Sometimes they had to wear it for a month or a year, sometimes for their entire lives. And afterwards, these Sanbenitos, when they were allowed to remove them, they were permanently placed in the churches with names affixed to them so that the memory of a converso's flirtation with their prior religion or even ancestral religion would be marked. All right, let's get our terminology right. So I've been using the term crypto-Jews, which seems to be kind of the scientific norm. Crypt in the sense of being hidden, being underground, right? They're actually Jewish. They think of themselves as Jews, but they are underground Jews, and they are externally presenting themselves as Christian. This is a term that does not carry a lot of moral opprobrium with it. It's a kind of term that is neutral in tone and so on. Another term would be conversos, which means converts, and this refers to the fact that the crypto Jews were themselves Jews who had converted to Christianity, willingly or otherwise, or were the children of such people. One of the rather frightening aspects of the entire period that we're studying tonight is the fact that this just slid so nicely into a kind of early medieval racism, because it didn't matter if you or your spouse converted, your children would also be in that status. They could be raised in the church from the moment of their birth, but nevertheless, they would still be in that kind of status. And in several cases, these purity of blood statutes were published that specifically designated lineages. Once again, we were reminded, if you go back to some of the earlier lectures this season, we spoke about the Raoul Hilberg, the great Holocaust historian, who made tremendous amount of analysis of the Holocaust by looking specifically at the mechanics, the bureaucracy of the Spanish Inquisition, and that's certainly, I think, true in the way that these people were called conversos, or so-called converts. They're also called new Christians, and the emphasis here is on the word new, meaning as opposed to the rest of us who have been Christian since at least the 4th or 5th century, these are new Christians. They're not real Christians. They've just been attached to the body of the church, and we can't really trust them. These are new Christians, not quite, you know, well within the fold. They're bona fides. Literally, their good faith is not yet established. The Hebrew term that's preferred and was preferred by the crypto-Jews themselves and the Jewish community was anusim. Anus, la-anos in Hebrew means to force. It's sometimes used in the context, for example, of a sexual assault. It's a very strong word, and it implies that their agency was completely removed from them, which is true in the vast majority of cases, that they were in fact forced to become Christians and they had no choice about it whatsoever. Sometimes they're called mishumadim. I didn't list it here. Mishumadim is not a complimentary term in Hebrew, and it means that they chose to convert, and they were therefore they were looked down upon. But primarily the term anusim, or forced, was used. And finally, a term that was very popular about 20 years ago, but it has now come appropriately into disfavor, Marrano. Marrano is the Spanish word for swine. And so obviously this term was used by Christians as a derogatory term against the conversos or crypto Jews, and so it's really not the appropriate term to use in this kind of context. But all told, these are all referring to the same people, although as we shall see, many of those Jews came into their Christian identities, however tenuous, with very different motivations. Let's have a look at that on this identity spectrum, which is analyzed by Dr. Gitlitz in actually far greater detail than I think we should go through today. I just want to give you just a sense of how the scope of identification with Christianity took place among the crypto Jews. And let us recall, by the way, that the period that we're speaking about is basically from the early 1300s until the present day. We're speaking about centuries of development of identification for these crypto Jews. So if we put Christianity over here on the left side of the spectrum and Judaism on the right side of the spectrum, some basic blocks that we could place these crypto Jews in would be as follows. You would have over here a certain number of converts who were in fact true believers. We should not obfuscate. There are definitely many Jews who felt, for reasons that we shall see shortly, in fact, Christianity was a preferred religion, and that Christianity was closer to the will of God than Judaism. And so many of them chose it openly and willingly, and later, in fact, dedicated their lives to convincing their erstwhile co-religionists to do the same. So you definitely have some. The term in Hebrew for these people would certainly be mishumadim, but they are definitely not in the majority. Then you have many who were converted, and especially their children, who grew up then in the church with a clear consciousness of their Jewish origin, but they kind of became resigned to it, and they regarded themselves as Christian reformers, or, this is my term, neo-Protestants, meaning they looked at themselves after, let's say, being Christian for 20, 30 years, or their children who grew up Christian, knowing that their parents were originally Jewish, and they said, you know, it was terrible that they forced us to convert, but, you know, we got along, and here we are, and life goes on. And the truth is, the church really should change. They should stop some of these egregious activities, and we can be the agent of this change. They were not like desperate to run back to Judaism, but they felt like their cultural superiority would lend to the advancement of Christianity as a more humanistic sort of faith. Let us not forget that the Jews had a far higher rate of universal, particularly male, literacy, and as a result, these people tended to be quite upwardly mobile in social and economic circuses. So once they were converted to Christianity and they were able to shed all of the economic baggage that and legislative baggage that held them back, they were actually able to rise up into the upper middle class and sometimes the towering upper classes of wealth and status, marrying into very high families and so on. So you tend to find those people sort of in this camp here where they're saying, all right, we're Christians, but you know, we're going to try and make Christianity a nicer place. Then you have probably the largest group, and all of this is supposition based on Gitlitz's research, but it stands to reason, who are low-profile Christians, who were terrified of the persecutions that met anyone who adopted any Jewish attitudes or behaviors. We'll explore the kind of punishments that would accrue to them if they were to demonstrate that they were identifying with Jews in any way or Judaism. So, but they resented the fact that they were converted. They didn't see a way out. So they just kept a very low profile. And when the time was right, or when they felt they were safe, and they would perhaps share a little bit of the information with their children, sometimes their children were raised not knowing at all that they were in fact Jewish, and then they became, you know, you have the term Jews by choice. So they had a lot of people who were what they call Jews by surprise. Right? And we have that, by the way, even in the 20th and 21st century, where you have in Poland, where many Jews hid their identity during the war and they became orphans, and then afterwards they find out they're outed, so to speak, to be Jews. So this is probably the largest single demographic chunk are low-profile Christians. They aren't doing what Christians have to do. They are aware of their Jewish identity, and they just keep it on the down low. Then you have over here passive Judaizers. The term Judaizing, by the way, is preferred by the church, and this refers to Christians who are adopting Jewish ideas or taking on Jewish behaviors. They are, of course, Jews ethnically and according to Jewish halacha, but they're only Judaizers when they start to actually practice Judaism. So passive Judaizers, these are Jews who have converted to Christianity, resent it, identify themselves as Jews internally, but feel that they simply cannot do so in the outside world. And so, therefore, they observe Judaism passively whenever possible. So, for example, they will not eat on Yom Kippur. Right? They won't, they're not going to, put on a yarmulke or something like that, but they will not eat on Yom Kippur. Or they will refrain from wearing shoes on Tisha B'Av. They will try to keep some sense of the calendar, and they will step back from Judaism wherever possible. This was in itself quite a risky act, as we shall see, and one could be exposed to the rigors of the Inquisition even for doing a passive act, an act of omission. Finally, the last category were the active Judaizers, and these are Jews who are desperately trying to hang on to their Jewish identity through actual covert acts. They are actually engaging in prayer in a Jewish context. They are a tremendous risk circumcising their sons. They are doing all kinds of things that are active demonstrations of their Jewish identity, despite the fact that this exposes them to phenomenal risk. Gathering in private homes for prayer quorums, where even if one of them were caught, the entire group would be sucked into the Inquisition. Absolutely terrifying kind of existence. But this gives you a sense of like the very many ways that Jews could identify. That's an excellent and very sophisticated question. I will give a very short answer for the people in the audience who may not have gone all the way back to St. Augustine-type lectures, fourth-century type stuff. But here's the thing. The church has this irritating problem. What do you do theologically with the Jews? Right? If it's kind of like if you think about a computer, and you get like a great Windows XP. I really liked XP. XP was so solid, hardly ever crashed, right? And then all of a sudden, Windows comes out with a new model. And they roll out the new model, and they sell all new computers with a new model. So what do you do if after 6 months with the new Windows out there, and people start saying, hey, we want to go back to XP, or we'd rather not upgrade? You might be able to eventually get 80% of Windows users with the new, whatever it is, Windows 2000. But the fact that there's some people who are holding out and saying, we want to keep XP going, that makes the new Windows look bad, right? So the church has a difficult issue. How do you deal with that? On the one hand, what you could do is you could extirpate them completely, God forbid, genocide or any other form of like simply removing their culture, which is a difficult thing to do in the medieval and in the ancient world. We didn't really try it as a global society until the Holocaust, but let's say they did that. The theological problem with that is that there would be no surviving Jews around to testify or witness that the Messiah had come. Because it only really counts if the XP user sees the new Windows and says, yeah, that's actually better than XP. Otherwise, everyone's wondering, why don't we just go back to XP? He's very happy with XP. Look what he does with XP. So the church developed this doctrine called the Doctrine of Witness. It was probably best articulated by St. Augustine in the 4th century, later by Pope Gregory the Great, that the Jews must be kept alive. They may not be forcibly converted. They may not be excessively harassed or punished. They're supposed to live in a second-class state, but we're not going to actually destroy them outright. So that's essentially church doctrine. The problem is, it's a very hard doctrine to explain to average people, and particularly when there is a an updraft of popular resentment of the Jews that can be expressed in terms of violence, in terms of popular anger, then it sort of bubbles over into these massacres like the Crusades or like the massacres of the 14th century. And when that happens, you know, what do you do with these Jews? What do you do if they have been forcibly converted? Then you're stuck with this idea, like we saw with Edgardo Mortara, that they are in fact Jewish and a Christian and there's no going back. So basically, the answer to your question is, the church had a doctrine. There were things that happened, particularly from the lower clergy. The often illiterate lower clergy would stir up economic distress in the masses, and they would have these excesses, like forced conversions, which the popes generally said, it's a bad thing, it's against our doctrine, please don't do it. But nevertheless, once they're converted, now what do you do with these new Christians? So it represents an attempt to deal with a situation that got out of hand in the first place. I'll show you clearly in just a couple of slides. Okay? Thank you for that excellent question. Nobody else ask any hard questions like that, because it's going to take us way off topic. Okay, so how many people are we talking about? How many crypto Jews are there? Here's some numbers. The numbers are astounding. So let's just do kind of a baseline. And by the way, these numbers, they're ranges because we don't have really good demographic data from the period. Gitlitz does a great job of surveying the major opinions. He takes a whole chapter to discuss what I'm going to put on one slide here. So I'm painting with the broad strokes, but you'll get the sense. So in 1491, which is, of course, the year before the expulsion, we're talking about something like 7 to 9 million Spaniards, including Muslims and Jews. And in Portugal, you got about 1 to 1.5 million people there. Of those, about 125 to 200,000 Jews were living in Spain. And about the same number, about 225 conversos from the various campaigns of the 14th century. So by the time we get to the expulsion, we've discussed this in previous lectures, but by the time you get to the expulsion, you've got about 50% of the Jews who are still traditionally part of the Jewish community, and you have 50% who are now nominally converted and find themselves somewhere on that spectrum that we saw earlier. It's a big chunk of the population. And one of the main reasons for the eventual expulsion is because the conversos were still associating with Jews, still marrying with Jews, still very much part of the community, and the lines were blurred. In Portugal, quite a few less, about 10 to 20,000, and a very few conversos. In 1492, somewhere between 100 and maybe as many as 160,000 Jews were expelled, an incredibly awful upheaval. A demographic change is hard to imagine, and we've spoken about it in previous lectures. About 50,000 of those went to Portugal. The Jews who decided to remain and converted, not only right on the eve of expulsion, but into the following decade, because the Jews who went to North Africa, especially in Morocco, they were actually turned away by the local Jewish community, who was not willing to accept a large amount of refugees, even though they were co-religionists, and other Jews who turned back because of the fear of traveling across the Mediterranean, or even the difficulty and expense of getting into Portugal, where only wealthy people got 8-month visas and so on. We're talking about 30 to 60,000 extra Jews converted in that decade, beginning with the expulsion. So we're speaking about somewhere just shy of 200,000 Jews who became crypto Jews of one form or another by 1502. And then if you take that forward and you look at, well, what happened to the Inquisition treatment of those Jews? And the Inquisition, for our intents and purposes, extends from the 13th century to the 1820s. It lasted for centuries before it was finally shut down. We're thinking something like 25 to 50,000 Spanish Jews, 30,000 Portuguese Jews. The Portuguese, again, these are the Portuguese Jews are originally Spanish. Many moved into Portugal, and about 4,000 Jews who were tried by the Inquisition in the colonies, including Brazil, Mexico, the New World, and so on. So we're talking massive numbers of people over a very long period of time fall into this category of crypto Jews. Let me add one last thing. If we look at one of the... So let's talk about the historical development. How exactly did all these people become crypto Jews? We've spoken in generalities. Let's just dig down a little bit deeper. So the truth is, here's another scene, by the way, of an auto da fe. Not all of those tens of thousands of Jews that are mentioned in the prior slide were killed, but a very large number, certainly five digits worth, were actually executed in the flames that were called auto da fe, or auto de fe in Portuguese, means the acts of faith. The burning was an act of faith. So here's a public auto da fe. You can see all the Jews here and their sanbenitos who are about to be executed. And it was a pageant-like environment where all of these Jews would receive absolution by being killed. So it really starts, ironically, in France in the early 14th century. Jews were expelled there, and many of them crossed the Pyrenees from Navarre into Spain. Many of them were forcibly converted, and so these are the first real conversos that made their way into Spain in any numbers. But let us recall what happens with conversos on an economic level. We can never really lose sight of how these decisions and persecutions affect the economy. Realize that the Jews had tremendous mercantile skills for the era. They had literacy, often in seven languages. They had international connections to be able to engage in long-distance trade. They had a strong internal legal system of the Talmud that would regulate all of their interpersonal dealings. And so it was very easy for them, for Jews, to rely on a heavy infrastructure of trust that would enable them to engage in significant mercantile activities. So the only thing that really held them back were the many restrictions of anti-Semitic legislation that forced them not to engage in certain trades, not to live in certain neighborhoods, not to sell certain items, or various kinds of aspects of social interchange. So once the Jews were converted, they technically kept all of the advantages of being Jewish and lost all of the disadvantages. And so they represented a very disruptive element in the economy. You can imagine, like, let's say, for example, we had, superheroes walking among us. Think like Marvel, X-Men, or something like that. Mutants, right? And they've got super strength, and they can fly, and things like that. And we try to keep them down by passing legislation. No flying in New York City. And all of a sudden, we remove all those things, and they're flying all over the place. You know, Uber would be out of business in a minute, because you would just catch a Lyft with a superhero. So a lot of things changed when the Jews were released from the shackles of this legislation. And so there was economic unrest. A series of riots ensued in Aragon, which is a region of Spain where many of these Jews entered. And after some duress, the local king allowed the papacy to bring in the Inquisition. The Inquisition had been established about 100 years prior, and the purpose of the Inquisition, originally in France, was to try and control heterodox Christians, the Cathars and so on, who were abandoning traditional Catholic ideology, and the Inquisition was designed to try and root out that heresy. But it could also be used for Jews who were converted to Christianity and then were Judaizing. So the king agreed, they invited the Inquisition into Aragon, and right away it started its nefarious work, which of course would continue for another 600 years. There are sporadic attacks on Jews throughout the century as the resistance to these conversos grew, and there was a significant amount of economic upheaval. And you have a major change in 1378 when an archdeacon named Ferran Martinez, and archdeacon is a fairly low-level position. Recall that the lower clergy is often illiterate, often can't even read the scripture that they are preaching. But, you know, if they get up and engage in demagoguery and stand on a soapbox and make a lot of loud noises and they inspire fear in the population, they can actually achieve a lot. This never happens in the 20th century or the 21st century, but I've been joking. I shouldn't even joke about those things. But anyway, Martinez specifically attacked the Jews of Seville, and he inspired a series of riots. The king, who is typically hesitant to engage in anti-Jewish persecutions, I don't want to go into great detail today, but for the most part, kings tended to be protectors of Jews because the Jews were a great source of income. And so the king doesn't want public disturbance, doesn't want neo-revolutionary activity, would rather keep everyone quiet. But under Martinez's rabble-rousing, he eventually agrees, and Martinez appeals to the Pope to try and impose even stricter legislation against the Jews and even greater activity of the Inquisition. In 1391, there is a wave of attacks that basically occupies the entire peninsula, and Jews are converted by the tens of thousands. In every community, there are attacks on Jews, sometimes multiple times, and this is where you get the bulk of the conversos, primarily from that massive upheaval in 1391. But the fact is, this is 100 years before expulsion. You know, that's how we get to that number of about half of the Jews in Spain being conversos 100 years later. Let's try and and let's also understand, besides the violence that I have described, we also have a few of these really prominent celebrity conversions that spur the movement along from within the Jewish sphere. Perhaps the most famous of them is this individual, Shlomo Halevi of Burgos, who was known by his baptized name, Pablo de Santa Maria, who engaged in a correspondence that survived with a Jewish man named Yehoshua from the town of Lorque. So he's called Yehoshua HaLorki. And Yehoshua wrote to Santa Maria and said, you know, I don't understand why you converted to Christianity. It's like such an amazing thing to me. You were a very learned person. You were a rabbi. You knew so much. How could you just convert? This is not someone who was like forcibly converted as a result of violence. He became Christian. So HaLorki sort of proposes an answer to his own question. He says, the only reason why someone would want to convert to Christianity, he says, would be one, for career mobility, social mobility, and for career advancement, right? As I've mentioned, they have a tremendous amount of advantage if they become Christian. They lose all of the anti-Semitic baggage holding them back. So that's one reason why someone would want to become Christian, says HaLorki. Or number two, perhaps it's related to Averroism, which is the name of a philosopher of the period, and associated with the idea of stepping back from religion as the prime locus of verity, and instead looking to things like science and reason, and essentially a secularism. So maybe your religious ideas sort of cooled off, and then you figured, well, in this environment, Christianity is maybe more amenable to my new kind of broader thinking. Yeah, possible. Third reason a person might convert is perhaps by looking at Jewish history and saying it's clear from the pattern of Jewish history, from the trajectory all the way from the destruction of the temples through the exile, the Bar Kokhba revolution that failed and so on. Maybe it's clear from all these things that God has abandoned the Jews. Or perhaps it is really belief that Christianity is true, that it represents a fulfillment of the prophecies of the Torah, and that's why a person would become Christian. Now, HaLorki ended his correspondence by saying, well, since I know that you are a great rabbi, you are a very learned individual, and you chose Christianity, it cannot have been for the first three reasons, because you are such a great man. It must be you converted for the last reason, that you truly believe that Christianity was the fulfillment of Judaism, and therefore HaLorki also converted. He took the name Jeronimo de Santa Fe, and he played a major role as the prime defender of Christianity in a forced disputation in Tortosa in 1414. So this is kind of like two celebrity conversions that had a huge impact on the Jews. And we have to imagine how over the course of nearly 200 years, they're losing confidence, they're losing strength, they're feeling dejected that, you know, where is God? Where is Mashiach? Why is this happening to us? How can this just keep going on? And when you have these kinds of figures convert, it just, it accelerates the entire motion altogether. People have less will to resist, and in many cases, people actually actively convert. Okay. Unfortunately for the conversos, the Inquisition proved to be absolutely horrific and deadly. I won't go into great detail about this because we have spoken about it in several other classes. But let us recall that the Inquisition was originally directed not at the Jews who remained Jewish, because they were not considered heretics. They were not considered backsliding Christians. They were just non-Christians. And they fell within the doctrine of witness. But once a Jew was baptized, that was it. There's no going back. And so any Jew who consorted, any converso who consorted with Jews would be subject to the dictates of the Inquisition. We shall see a little bit about how this operated in terms of the belief system of the crypto-Jews. But let us recall that what would happen is the conversos would be, you know, accused by a neighbor, let's say, who saw them, let's say, lighting candles on Friday night, perhaps placing them under clay pots or something like that. And then that would be reported to the Inquisition. A person would be brought in. There would be horrific tortures. After the tortures, they would typically betray so many other people they knew who did the same thing. They would be brought in. The Inquisition was paid for by confiscations from those accused and later killed by the Inquisition, so it proved to be quite in the interest of the Inquisition to accuse as many people as possible. And informants were also rewarded for their services, and therefore if you liked your neighbor's cow, chances are an easy way to get it would be simply say that, you know, they typically slaughter their cows moving left to right with a knife and things like that. So it's a terrifying kind of social phenomenon. I happened in my research saw a couple of these images that were terrifying. This is, the types of tortures are mind-blowing. This is a hand crusher. What I find fascinating about this is that the cross is placed on the hand crusher to remind the torturers and the tortured that this is all done for the greater glory of God, that this is what is commanded by the church. And then this horrible thing called the pear of anguish, or the Pope's pear, is a device, and there are thousands of these kinds of things, a device that can be inserted in one of any orifices in a human body, and then later it could be expanded like this, causing agonizing pain. So you have to imagine how these tools would have had such a horrific impact on the Jews of that time. Let us go back to these heroic crypto-Jews and try to understand a little bit about what was their belief. I mean, let's say, we have to imagine now, you know, we're looking at it, we're compressing several hundred years into less than an hour. But let's say you're living in, I don't know, 1530 or 1560, and it's already two, three, four generations since anyone has been able to openly practice Judaism. The Jews who did not convert were exiled from Spain and Portugal. The Jews who converted were on pain of the Inquisition to behave openly in any Jewish form. Here's a Jew wearing a San Benito. Of course, you can see the humiliating hat and the face that's drawn onto the San Benito as well. And you can imagine you'd have to wear this for literally months if you were lucky, and not be burned at the stake. So, if you're like in the 1530s, the 1560s, there's no teachers. Who can you go to learn something about Judaism? There's no books. A Hebrew book would itself be a death sentence. There's no Hebrew books. The only exception would be medical texts. And so therefore, Maimonides sometimes survived because he wrote so many medical tracts that were rendered sometimes into Hebrew, and also the ones originally written in Hebrew, like Hilchot Deot and so on. So you don't have anything to study except Christian materials, and you have to try and imagine what Judaism would do with, let's say, Christian translations of the Old Testament. You'll recall, if you were with us last year, we spoke about Uriel da Costa, a Portuguese Jew, who was raised in this environment. His mother came out as Jewish and said to him when he was about bar mitzvah, listen, I have to tell you, you're actually Jewish. And he was so enthused with this. He was so, you know, inspired by the fact that he was Jewish, that when they finally escaped Portugal and made it to Amsterdam, he like so openly embraced Judaism, was so happy to be there, but he felt crushing disappointment when he saw that regular Jews in Amsterdam didn't always behave with the high standards of the prophets. And he actually, it ate him up. He probably had significant mental illness. Ultimately, he was exiled from the synagogue three times, and the third and final time, he was actually forced by the community to lie down on the ground in front of the synagogue, and the entire community would walk over his back as an act of ritual humiliation to indicate that really he can't behave this way. Immediately after that, he went home and he shot himself. But he left behind a 12-page suicide note that is one of the most chilling documents in Jewish history. But he was like one of these people who wanted to be Jewish so badly, but he grew up with a very twisted idea of what is Judaism, because there was no rabbis there. There was no rebbetzins. There was no one there who can give him that information. Crypto-Judaism typically included a few key prayers, like the one line, Shema Yisrael, Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad. These kinds of things would be whispered and handed down generation to generation. But there's no way that they could, they would not have prayer books. They might have something like the contraband Portuguese work, The Consolations for the Tribulations of Israel by Shlomo Usque that we talked about a few weeks ago. But they would have no source material, so their prayers were just basically, you know, gibberish that was handed down, often incorrectly. And as I mentioned earlier, the kinds of observances that crypto-Jews tended to take on were things that were not openly visible. One of the most popular fasts, for example, surprisingly, is the fast of Esther. Why would the fast of Esther, you think, somehow retain more memory for crypto-Jews than, let's say, I don't know, the 17th of Tammuz or something like that? That's right, because Esther herself was a crypto-Jew in Ahasuerus's court. And it was available in the Christian Bible. The book of Esther is there. So crypto-Jews could read this and could really identify with her plight. And by the way, when she said she fasted 3 days, so the crypto-Jews, not knowing anything else, sometimes they fasted 3 days as well. I mean, they really went to tremendous lengths to try and do what it says in the Bible. Well, they had to guesstimate by the Christian holidays. So they knew that Purim is 1 month before Passover. Passover falls in April with Easter, more or less. So they would kind of backdate it, sometimes go by the Julian calendar and use date to date. But they often really had no idea. They obviously knew which day was Shabbat, and that was a big deal. And we'll see in a second in the Edicts of Faith what that meant. Gender differences, overwhelmingly more women than men. We definitely have lots of sociological research that indicates that women are a far more reliable repository of tradition than men. And you can look at a lot of different markers for this. For example, the age of intermarriage in America is men intermarry about 3 years before women do. Meaning women will wait 3 more years trying to find a Jewish mate before Jewish men will. That's just kind of like an American example. But the practices in the home, all practices that are associated with the kitchen, the bedroom, things like that, tend to be in women's domains, and they tend to preserve it far more likely than men do. And we have similar statistics among the crypto-Jews, at least in the 15th century. Ironically, this even applies to rituals that were associated with men alone. Circumcision, incredibly dangerous because it's a permanent mark, of course, and once you can't take it back. But women crypto-Jews who wish to somehow identify sometimes would actually, and this is a noted tradition, they would have themselves ritually scarified, usually on the shoulder. A small piece of skin would be removed as a token act of female circumcision to show their desire to cleave to the Jewish people. I think it's amazing that it has no source whatsoever in the Jewish tradition, but nevertheless, the idea that a woman would want so badly to identify with her people that she would engage in this, it's a phenomenal thought. Now, ironically, one of the places where crypto-Jews learned the most about Judaism and adapted to it was in these things called the Edicts of Faith. And I'm going to read to you a little bit of one. The Inquisition in order to root out people who are engaged in Judaizing activity, would typically come into a town, or they would announce that they're going to have an investigation, and they would attach in public places a long list of potential crimes. And they would publish this instead, essentially saying, was called the Edicts of Faith, also called the Edicts of Grace. And they would say, if you have seen any of your neighbors doing any of these things, report them immediately to the Inquisition. And if you were a crypto Jew and you read this list, you would, by seeing what they said, learn what you thought was something about Judaism. Aha, doing this must be what Jews in other countries do. And so ironically, even while the Inquisition was trying to extirpate Judaism, it was also encouraging it, although in a twisted kind of way. So I'm not going to read you the whole thing. This is like it's a four-page document here in Gitlitz's book, but let me give you a couple of examples. If any of you have seen or heard say that any person or persons have kept any Sabbaths in honor of the observance of the law of Moses, putting on clean personal linen and their best or festival clothing, placing clean linen on their tables or throwing clean sheets on their beds in honor of the Sabbath, not kindling a fire or doing any other work on those days, beginning on Friday afternoon. So right away, people get a sense of, so that's what you do for Shabbos, is you put on a fresh tablecloth, change the linens, wear nice clothes, right? You can see also how intrusive this was, that if you did these things, change the tablecloth on a Friday afternoon, you could be killed for it. I mean, it's an amazingly frightening thing. We should think about that next time we change the tablecloth. Or who have porged or deveined the meat they are preparing to eat, soaking in water to remove the blood, or who have removed the sciatic vein from the leg of mutton or from any other animal. Like, these are laws in Shechita. If you're making animals kosher, you have to remove certain veins and so on. Or who have cut the throat from one side to the other of any animals or birds which they're going to eat, saying, blessed be the Lord who has commanded us to slaughter in this fashion. First testing the knife on a fingernail to see if it has a sharp edge, and then covering the blood with earth. And by the way, much of this material was revealed to the church by people who were tortured by the Inquisition, and they would ask them these detailed questions, and they later codify them in potential crimes that could later be used against future victims. Or who have eaten meat during Lent or in other days forbidden by the Holy Mother Church, or who have fasted on the Great Fast, which is called the Fast of Pardon, going barefoot on that day. The Fast of Pardon is, of course, Yom Kippur, right? Or who have prayed Jewish prayers and in the evening have asked forgiveness of each other, the parents putting their hands on their children's heads without crossing them or saying anything, or saying, may you be blessed by God and me. Which is, of course, this is what I do every Friday night with my kids. And you can imagine that would put you at risk of death. Or who fast the fast of Queen of Esther or the fast of Rebbeaso, I don't know what that is, which they call the loss of the Holy Temple, maybe Tisha B'Av, but I don't know what Rebbeaso means in Spanish. Yeah, something like that. Or other fasts during the week, such as Mondays or Thursdays. Let's see, what else? Cutting nails and trimming hair, keeping or burning the cuttings, which in fact is the halacha, when you have your fingernails, you have to dispose of them certain ways. Praying Jewish prayers while raising and lowering their heads, which are turned face towards the wall, right? Shuckling, when you're davening by the Mizrachvand. Before they pray, washing their hands with water or with dirt, wearing garments of serge, terry cloth or linen with certain cords or little strings hanging down, right, like this here, little strings hanging down from the corners tied into certain knots, or who are, after they are baptized, they wash off the oil and chrism, right, like when they're baptized, they make sure to get rid of the whatever they use to baptize them. Or who on the seventh night after the birth of their child, they put it in a basin of water into which they place gold, silver, pearls, wheat, barley, and other things, washing the child in that water, saying, may you be as well supplied with the goods of this world as in this basin. That looks like some kind of indigenous Sephardic tradition. I don't know if it survived. It's a Sephardic custom? A pigeon, a ben? Yeah, okay. With water and stuff like that, and barley? Yeah. Okay, that's interesting. So there's a lot of things here. And so there's so many of these types of things. And the transcripts of Inquisition trials list in painful detail these specific tiny quotidian activities that the Jews may have been involved in. But that's ultimately the source of how these crypto-Jews were able to receive any kind of information about their faith, however distorted it often was. So we're coming to the end of this. What happened to all these Jews? Just simple mathematical calculation indicates there are about 100 million descendants of those crypto-Jews. If you want to take the strictest definition of who is a Jew, and you say it's all through the matrilineal line, we're still talking about double digits of millions of Jews who are just as Jewish as I am and have no conception of it whatsoever. This has ironically resulted, well, actually, what has been happening in the last few years with the advent of DNA testing services like Ancestry.com and 23andMe and things like that. Many people have discovered that they actually have Jewish Sephardic roots. And in fact, they can do some distinctions, whether it's a mitochondrial DNA or there was a Y type, haplotypes, things like that, whether it flows through the matrilineal or the patrilineal line. And all of a sudden you have hundreds of thousands of people who are claiming Jewish ancestry with almost no understanding of what that actually means. From the 19th into the 20th century, there were various travelers who would go way into the back villages, including, if any of you are going to come on that trip with me on the Douro this year, including villages off the Douro River in Portugal, of whole communities who say, yeah, we're all descended from the crypto-Jews. They're completely Christian in just about everything they do, but they have a consciousness of being essentially descended from converts. What do you do with these people? Many of them are so enthusiastic about coming back to Judaism that an organization called Reconectar, which is very active in Israel, is reaching out to such people when they find that they have Sephardic Jewish identity somewhere in their genetic history, and they're inviting them back into the Jewish body politic and saying, you know, we'll explain what you need to know and you can make your decisions. According to DNA testing, it appears that 1 in 20 males in Spain is of crypto-Jewish stock, and 1 in 15 American Hispanics in this country. The Northwest, actually that should say Southwest, sorry. I don't know who types these things up. Give these, so just ignore that, right? American, I was in a bit of a rush this morning. But it's a phenomenal thing that so many crypto-Jews are, because of science. Now, the science obviously does not make a Jew. There are many people with Jewish, there's a lot of things that go into it. But nevertheless, it does point to a renaissance of Sephardic Jewish identity from the most unlikely of sources. Those are my comments on this topic. I hope you found this as meaningful as I did. Next week, God willing, we'll have our concluding lecture on Harav Avadia Yosef. Back to the biographies, and I think you'll find his life absolutely fantastic and inspirational. Thank you very much for your attention. Hello, everyone. I hope you found that lecture interesting. I know that the material in Gitlitz's book is just overwhelming and absolutely fascinating, and just want to share one last concluding thought. I find it so tremendously ironic on a historical level that, you know, the identity of these crypto-Jews was so tenuous under such tremendously challenging environmental circumstances, and nevertheless, so many of them made often the ultimate sacrifice to try and preserve whatever scraps of Jewish theology or practice or belief they could preserve for themselves and for future generations. And we contrast that with the way we live here in contemporary North America, with incredible wealth and unprecedented freedom and the ability to explore our Jewish background and our Jewish heritage, Jewish thought, Jewish ideas. You know, there's such a range of possibilities for Jews today, and yet the vast majority of American Jews remain completely disconnected from their Jewish heritage. That's, you know, it's one of those shocking realities that that's hard to pass over.
You know, if you had a chance to watch the Jewish History Manifesto video that I recorded a long time ago, it kind of crystallizes my thinking in putting together this Jewish history series, and I'm hoping that people will, you know, get some kind of motivation to explore the greater aspects of Jewish identity and thought, the tremendous wealth that's present there, and that massive contribution to human civilization. And I hope, you know, people will share this video or share other videos or go look at other videos done by other people. The whole point is to try and expand awareness of the tremendous beauty of this civilization and heritage. Okay, thank you very much for your attention, and final lecture of this spring 2018 season will be coming up. I hope you have a great week.